don't stand in front of him.
Thank you.
does not withdraw love from us. Even when we fail to love others and struggle to love ourselves, God's love is steadfast. Let us lift our prayers to God. Holy One,
we love you imperfectly. We do not always keep your commandments.
We love each other imperfectly. We hurt those who call us to love through our actions and inactions.
We love ourselves imperfectly. We struggle to believe that we are truly your children, made in your image. Forgive us. By the power of your Spirit, make us more faithful, that we might live as Christ has shown us, reflecting your love and grace. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Because Christ lives, we also live. Not because anything we have done, not because of our belief or faithfulness, we live because Christ lives.
This is the Christ who forgives us. This is the God who is within us. This is the Spirit who is with us.
Hallelujah.
Praise be to God.
We're so glad that you're here. Before we get to announcements, we have a practice. It's not required, but if you are new, a first-timer visiting, and would like to stand up and say who you are and where you're coming from, we'd love to be able to greet you by name. Is there anyone who'd like to? Yes?
Jim and Sandy DeVries from Dallas, Texas.
Jim and Sandy. That's literally my parents' name. It's so nice to meet you guys. We're so glad you're here. Anyone else?
Sonia and Andrew, we're from Seattle, and my parents are next.
Yes, Sonia and Andrew, we're so glad you guys are here. From where? Wow. Wow, you guys get the farthest travel to work. We're so glad you're here. Welcome. We're so glad you're here. Anyone else? Y'all look pretty familiar. Well, we're glad that all of you are here. And if you've been here a while and this is starting to feel like home and the place where you want to work out your faith journey, the session receives new members every month. We'll meet Thursday, and it's quite painless. We just ask for a confession of faith in the grace of Christ, whatever that means to you. And the desire to be a faithful member, knowing we'll do so only ever imperfectly. Announcements can be found on the back of your bulletin. Are there any that folks would like to highlight or anything that's not on there? Yes?
I figured. Today is the last concert for the Taos Community Chorus, and it's at St. James. It's 3 o'clock. For those of you who didn't come last week or yesterday, you have another chance. And I'll be singing again, and the chorus is doing really well, and we really thank you for all the support that you've already given. So, thanks.
Thank you. I've heard it's amazing. So, 3 p.m. you said?
3 p.m. at St. James.
At that other church down the road.
And there's a potluck afterwards, so.
Oh, all right. Y'all come. I'll draw your attention to this Tuesday at, oh yes, Linda.
Just two things. Our Super Bowl Sunday hand drive is kind of dwindling, so if you don't mind grabbing a can or two when you come in, maybe next few Sundays I can go and meet some hampers out here. And I'm also starting around in shelter for the 25th.
The 25th. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Food of many kinds. Great. Any other announcements? I know we've got one special thing to sing about in just a moment, so don't let me forget. But first, I do want to call y'all's attention to, we're starting another book study. This one, there will be biblical scripture Bible study, but it will mostly be around this book, Between the Listening and the Telling. When I go on sabbatical, y'all are going to be telling stories. So we're going to start learning sort of how to do that and why storytelling matters. If you'd like to join us Tuesdays at noon and you don't have a book, you're welcome to borrow mine, talk to me, or we can order you one. But and I've got some for a couple of y'all that have ordered. But join us either in person or on Zoom. The link and code are there. We'd love to have you with us. All right, any other announcements? Carol.
So. This year, pretty much every year, we try to do an annual review of staff, including our beloved pastor. Now, Session is going to be doing this on Thursday. We're collecting feedback. So if you have something that you'd like to say about Jenna, especially if it's cool, talk to somebody who's on Session. Could Session members raise your hands? There's a bunch around. Yeah, so talk to somebody. So we can make sure that we have a full reflection. Thank you,
Carol. And if you have something bad to say, maybe I should always direct criticism towards Sessions. That'd be fun. All right. Anything else, folks? All right. Then I'll invite our children to come forward for a minute on the steps before heading to Sunday school. Hey, Joshua. How are you?
Hello.
How are you? Jolie. All right, let's do names since there are some new folks. My name is Jenna.
Joshua.
Gideon.
Jolie.
Awesome. What's one exciting thing that happened this week for you guys? Anything?
We got, our mom and dad got a new couch and they changed it to Florence and we watched the new Puss in Boots.
They got a new couch that it seems like maybe it's a recliner, it changes forms, and they watch the new Puss in Boots. I didn't know there was a new one, but now I know what I'm doing.
It changed into a bed.
It changed into a bed? Oh, that's awesome. Well, great. So it was nominated for Best Picture, you said?
No, it was nominated for Best Animated Feature, I think.
Okay.
Pinocchio won, so yeah.
Oh, Pinocchio. Get you every time. Oh, is it good?
Yeah, the stop motion one is really good.
All right. So anything exciting that happened for you this week?
Just plans for high school.
Plans for high school.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I'm actually going to New Mexico School for the Arts this year, so yeah.
Did y'all hear that? Jolie's going to New Mexico School for the Arts.
Yeah. Five.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Oh, I'm so excited for you. All right. Well, so today y'all are going to head to Sunday School with Stan. But we are going to talk about a time that the Apostle Paul, he went in somewhere and he couldn't really read the crowd at first. Do you guys know what that means?
Crowd's like a lot of people.
Right. Well, he was sort of speaking the wrong language, not like Spanish or French, but he wasn't sort of saying things that people understood. Because it is kind of, do you guys ever talk to your parents or your grandparents and it feels like you're just in different worlds? The teenager nods. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Me too sometimes. Does it ever help when someone gets down maybe like eye level with you and just says, why don't you tell me what it's like? Why don't you tell me how you're doing?
Good.
Good, does that feel good? Yeah, I love it when someone does that. And they just listen. They just listen to you. Maybe they understand, maybe they don't. But I think there's a lot of power in just listening. Do you guys feel like you have parents or grandparents or friends that listen to you?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I know, you've got some good ones. Awesome. Well, I am remembering that I said not to forget and then did.
Before we send you to Sunday school, we need to sing a little song. Today is, whose birthday is it today? You know?
Gamali's.
Is that what we call grandma? Yes, it's Libby's birthday. And maybe we could make it also a congratulations to Jolie. So we'll sing happy birthday, but we'll, does that work?
No, sure.
Sure, okay, awesome. Sure.
So he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and also in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Also, some Epicureans and Stoic philosophers debated with him. Some said, "What does this babbler want to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a proclaimer of foreign divinities." This was because he was telling the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. So they took him and brought him to the Areopagus and asked him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? It sounds rather strange to us, so we would like to know what it means." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners living there would spend their time in nothing but telling or hearing something new. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything. Since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things, from one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. In him we live and move and have our being. As even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man who he has appointed. And all of this has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. When they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some scoffed, but others said, "We will hear you again about this." At that point, Paul left them, but some of them joined him and became believers, including Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. This is the word of our God.
Thanks
be to God. The epistle reading is 1 Peter 3, 13 through 22. "Now, who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated, but in your heart sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you.
yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins, once and for all, the righteousness for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey when God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which is prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from your body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with the angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of our God. Thank you, Pop-Up Choir, and Mark and Dan. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from John's Gospel, chapter 14, verses 15 through 21. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees her nor knows her. You know her because she abides with you, and she will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. The Gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We church people have a bad habit of answering questions that no one is asking. Take Paul. He is a well-educated Pharisaic Jew turned Christian. He knows the scriptures backward and forward. He's an expert in Torah and rabbinic teachings. And since his conversion on the road to Damascus, he's been traveling from city to city and preaching a distinctly Christian gospel, a version of salvation history, telling how the God who made a promise to Abraham and delivered the Hebrew people out of Egypt has now brought that promise to fulfillment through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And when Paul arrives in Athens, he is bursting at the seams with this good news to share. And quite frankly, nobody cares. Athens is a marvelous city with its own long history. It's the former capital of the ancient Greek Empire. The people of Athens have their own pantheon of gods and goddesses, their own stories and philosophical traditions about how the world works. Abraham is the city of Socrates. No one is asking questions about Abraham and Moses. Paul is operating out of an entirely different worldview. He sees idols. The Athenian people see statues honoring their gods. Paul is preaching the answers to questions that no one is asking. It would be, perhaps, like waltzing up to the Mayo Clinic and asking if they know about the healing properties of crystals and bee pollen. So Paul changes his approach. He leaves the synagogue and goes to the marketplace, the center of public life. He engages local philosophers in public debate, and eventually they get curious, and they ask him about this new teaching and this new God. And this is where I think Paul really finally gets it. He meets the people of Athens right where they are. He tells the story of Jesus using their own stoic philosophical language. Instead of quoting the Hebrew scriptures as he does in the synagogues, Paul quotes the Greek poets, the ones the people of Athens would know and consider sacred. And, maybe the best part, Paul begins his preaching with the very idols that he was initially so distressed by. He's been studying them, it turns out, reading their inscriptions, and has found an altar dedicated to an unknown god. Presumably, scholars think this was there in case the Athenians had forgotten anybody in their ever-expanding pantheon of gods and goddesses. But this is where Paul finds his entryway, a foothold for the gospel. Essentially, Paul tells the people of Athens, what I have is a new ending to a story you already know. The gospel I preach answers the questions that your people and my people are asking. You don't have to change who you are to receive this good news. God's story is big enough for your worldview and mine. Paul meets the people of Athens where they are, and he listens. He learns what's important to them. And he gets a hearing. He even gains disciples in Athens because he finally starts answering the right questions. Last week, I attended a small gathering of Presbyterian pastors from across the country. And it was good to be among friends and colleagues and realize that we're all pretty much in the same place. Big church or small church, urban, suburban, or rural, monocultural or multicultural, big endowment or barely getting by, all of our churches are experiencing more or less the same things. We're exhausted. We're smaller than we used to be. We're aging. And we feel threatened by cultural irrelevance. Now, this is not unique to churches. In our postmodern, post-COVID, post-Christendom, post-everything world, every institution and industry is facing some sort of crisis of who we are and how we do what we do. Banks, healthcare, schools, and don't even get me started on the airline industry. But with churches in particular, I do sometimes wonder if we find ourselves floundering because we, like Paul, are answering questions that no one is asking. Questions like, what should I do with that free time on Sunday morning? Is there one more activity I could fit into my already packed schedule? Am I going to hell? What should I believe about politics, racism, gender identity, you name the topic? What makes your denomination better than the other denominations? I have a long list if anyone does ask that question. And perhaps my favorite question that you're answering that no one is asking, do you guys have a committee where I could serve? People aren't asking these questions, are they? With all we've been through in recent years, we have neither the time nor the emotional energy for questions like these. Our minds and hearts are preoccupied with questions that feel far more urgent. Questions like, how will I take care of my aging mother? Is this marriage going to last? Will I be able to afford new clothes for my kid this year? Or will I get behind on the mortgage? Will my sister ever forgive me? Why doesn't my grandson visit anymore? Is there anything that could stop make me stop feeling this lonely? And if they knew the real me, would they still love me? Sound familiar? Maybe you've asked a few of these questions yourself. This time we're living in is characterized by a kind of existential anxiety, one that we can feel in our bones. Studies are showing how we as a people are really lonely. We're overextended. We're increasingly divided and even estranged from one another along partisan lines. And the questions we're asking of God and the universe don't seem to be about doctrine or belief. They're about relationship, about community, about how we live together as a people. At this retreat, a colleague of mine named Chris, who is both a pastor and a community organizer, shared one of the things he's found most helpful in navigating life and ministry in this time. He said it's a strategy he learned from community organizing finding people's hidden prayers. As a community organizer, Chris said that he learned quickly every effective action begins with one-on-one meetings. People just sitting down and getting to know one another. No agenda, no business allowed, just time of sharing your stories, your passions, your dreams, your fears. And during meetings like this, he said, things begin to bubble up. Shared interests, common values, questions, concerns, those things that wake you up in the middle of the night. All of these, he said, are our hidden prayers. It's hard to do anything meaningful together as a church or a community if we don't know each other's hidden prayers, isn't it? And what's more, we cannot preach or embody the gospel in any meaningful way if we don't know the hidden prayers of our community. What are the questions that people are asking? Not just in this room, but especially outside of it. We who have hitched our lives to the gospel of Jesus Christ believe that it does have power to transform the world. That all this talk of love, justice, and forgiveness is not just an empty promise. That we are, in fact, here to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, welcome strangers, visit the sick and imprisoned. That good does triumph over evil. And that love is stronger than death every single time. Most days, I believe that, or some version of it. It speaks to my deepest longings, my hidden prayer. And that's all well and good. But is it really the gospel if it doesn't make a difference in the lives of those around me? Like Paul, I have no interest in a gospel that speaks only one language or that meets only my needs. So friends, let's go out there. Let's listen. Let's be present with one another and with our neighbors. Let's learn what it is that they are longing for, their needs, their hunger, their hidden prayers. Instead of proclaiming that Jesus is the answer, I wonder what would happen if the church would take a step back and find out what the question is. Amen. Friends, rise in body or spirit and join in singing hymn number 450, Be Thou My Vision.
Walking on.
receive Christ's peace. So let us take that moment, take a moment and share that peace with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Share signs of peace.
Thank you for all your work. Peace be with you.
And for those who long or have longed to be mothers but are not,
God, may we remember that you indeed are the mother of us all, and that you see us, hear us, accept us, and love us exactly as we are this day. And therefore, we lift up to you now, in silence and aloud, the joys and sorrows on our hearts this morning. Friends, for whom and for what do we pray today?
We pray for strength and healing for our friend Rosalie, who has lost her partner unexpectedly during a hospital visit.
For friend Rosalie, who lost her partner unexpectedly. For strength and healing, God, in your mercy.
My husband's uncle, who's just recently been placed on hospice, and my girlfriend, who lost her mother 2 weeks ago.
For William's uncle, recently placed on hospice, and a girlfriend who lost her mother recently. God, in your mercy.
My mother, Roberta Courtney Myers, and how much she was there for me all the time.
For our dearly beloved Robbie and Ralph's mother, Roberta Myers, is no longer with us. God, in your mercy.
To the people of Ukraine who are still in battle with Russia, for the soldiers serving that country to defend their people.
For the people of Ukraine and for the soldiers there, God, in your mercy. Side of eternity, and for the blessing of being Jolie's mother. God, in your mercy. Pray for those waiting that point between test and diagnosis. God, in your mercy. Pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom. Before we receive the morning offering this morning, I invite Linda to give us a minute for mission about the upcoming Pentecost offering.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Studies show that children learn about 80% of what they will ever know before the age of 5. How much more is gained by the time they reach 20 or so? These are years when the young, the next generation of leaders in both faith and life, are nurtured. The 2023 Pentecost offering is our next big opportunity to tell our youth how much we care and want the best for them. The focus, supporting children at risk, youth and adults, 40% of what we give will help the children and youth in Taos. 60% will be given to the National Presbyterian Church to underwrite programs such as the Youth Triennium and the Young Adult Volunteer Program. We should look no further than our own Pastor Jenna to affirm the significance of this wonderful program. Thank you.
Didn't know I was getting a shout out. Thank you. It's been 11 years since I did it, and it was great.
Friends, let us receive the morning offering. Give generously. And minds through your word that we may follow you more faithfully.
Amen. Our final hymn is number 366, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Yeah.
go forth into this beautiful world that God so loves and listen to the people around you. Go forth and get to know one another, get to know your community. Go forth and ask the questions, for then we will know the answers. Go forth to love and serve the Lord, and as you go, may joy and nothing less guide you on the way. May you be blessed, and oh, may you be a blessing. And may light, love's own crucified and risen light, guide you and countless others all the way home. Amen.
That one right, I guess.
Yeah. And then we'll talk to you about it.